Hello guys, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whatever is applicable as per your time zone. Thanks for joining in. May I get the quick confirmation if you hear me okay? Nicholas, confirm if you hear me okay. Okay, perfect. Thank you. Thanks for the confirmation. Got some confirmation here. Perfect. Let's go ahead. So thanks again one more time for joining the webinar. My name is Bhaskar Dixit. I do have experience, 17 years of experience in IT. I started my career as a trainer initially and then lately moved to production. Almost 5.5 years I invested in a production line. Got the chance to work with the three organizations in that 5.5 years tenure. This is my second inning as a trainer and second tenure with the Koenig solution. There are different programs for the courses I deliver the training on. VMware Track, Horizon, and vSphere are the product I deliver the training on. Azure is the one which keeps me busy most of the time, and I'm pretty sure you guys are aware with the certification pattern of Microsoft. Earlier, they used to have a product-based certification, like certificate for Exchange Server, certificate for Windows Server or Link Server. We used to have a certificate like that. But now we have a role-based certification. Whatsoever the role we want to pursue our career in, or we want to learn the services or the concept or the technology, we have been given a role-based certification and as per that. For an example, the guy who is working as a network engineer on premises and need to know what are the network related services we have been given on Azure platform, AZ-700 course is there for. Someone is a security engineer, want to know security related services, AZ-500 is there. Though security is something people have a confusion, a lot of confusion about the security, and people expect if we are using the cloud service, especially the public cloud services, it means that cloud vendor gonna look after the things related with the services or security, the things related with the high availability, redundancy, and all that, which is not really true. And I'm pretty sure you guys have met with so many people so far who simply say cloud is not secure. And the fun part is they do not talk about any if and but, they simply say cloud is not secure, right? So that is something not true, because when we talk about security, when we talk about reliabilities, redundancies, these all things come under the shared responsibility. Something we gonna share, we gonna manage, something they gonna manage. When I say we, I'm talking about customer. When I say they, I'm talking about the service provider, regardless of who is that service provider, be it your Microsoft or Amazon, Google, or Alibaba. So we have been given a different program or the courses, like the guy who is working as a SOC analyst and need to know secure SOC related services available on Microsoft Cloud SC 200 course is there for. The guy who is working as an identity access management administrator, managing the identities, group account, and all that stuff, same thing, one needs to learn on cloud, SC 300 program is there, SC 300 course is there for, right? So I do have the associated certificates on that, and other than the associated certificate, these are the two badges I do have. One is a VMware certified instructor, and another one is a Microsoft certified trainer. So the agenda of this meeting or this webinar is to talk about well architect framework, means when we are going to deploy the services, service instances, or we're going to use the Azure services, how we can make the infra resilient. how we can ensure how we can optimize the cost, how we can ensure the security, what are the parameters we have been given, or what are the services we have been given which we can use. We have been given a one course or one program that is known as EZ305. Earlier, we used to have our two courses for the same. So in our EZ305, we talked about that all stuff. And this entire EZ305, where we have been given a total 11 modules, is based on this Well Architect framework. So we're going to have the introduction of Well Architect framework here, and then further, what are the tools or services or the concept we have been given which we can use to ensure the security. We will be talking about identities, what identity is, how we can make it secure, how we can grant the access to the users, how we're going to protect our network, because the security, if we talk about, we follow the approach that is called ZTM, Zero Trust Model. Okay, within that Zero Trust Model, different principles are followed there for the multiple foundation pillars. So we're going to have the idea about that. If I talk about the security or protection of the network, we have been given a firewall, VPN, we can route the traffic. And if we need to implement some governance requirement or the policies on resources we're going to deploy on Azure platform, do we have something for that? We will be talking about that. And then the further part, we're going to discuss about high availability, resiliencies. And as I said earlier, when we start using Azure services, not just Azure service, any of cloud service, we start extracting as a customer, okay? We are using the service from that specific vendor. We are paying to them. Now they're going to look after each and everything for us, which is, again, not true, just like a security. Because high availability, resiliencies, and like redundancy, that all this stuff actually comes under the shared approach. We're going to ensure the security. So if we are using a compute service, if I talk about compute service only, compute services are categorized under IaaS category. Some of the services on Azure platform, we have been given categorized under PaaS category. So how are we going to ensure any compute service available under IaaS category? How are we going to ensure the redundancy of the service available under the PaaS? We will be having the high-level idea about that. And if we need to have the BCDR, business continuity, what are the tool and services we have been given? Further, we will be talking about the factor which can make impact on the cost, which can increase or help us to control the cost. What are the factors we should consider before deploying the resources over there? And then further, in order to talk about the operation excellence, we're going to talk about how we will be setting up the monitoring using a unified monitoring tool we have been given in there that is known as Azure Monitor. Basically, Azure Monitor is the collection of the two, not the single two. We have been given a smart alert over there. We have been given a log analytic workspace. We have been given an insight. When I say insight, VM insight, application insight, network insight, AVD insight, different things we have been given in that. So when and what can be used, that is what we will be talking about. In here only, we will be talking about alert and actions. That all this stuff need to be covered in 1 hour or few minutes. So I will be trying to give you the holistic view of the things. Then further, you have been given the course, the books of that stuff is available on MS Learn. Or you can just go for the another like program that is an instructor-led program. Okay, so that all stuff, cost optimization, redundancy, availabilities, how we will be ensuring that is stuff covered in our EZ305. For these, this entire foundation Well Architect framework or the Well Architect framework we have been given. For that stuff, we have been given a total 11 modules. Some of them talked about identities, how we'll ensure the protection of the identities, when we should go with the cloud identities, or when we should start using hybrid identities. When we say identity, I believe everyone knows that. identity is an object used for authentication authorization. It might be representing your user account, your employees in your organization, your devices, your services, or the applications. Okay, so how we can manage them, that stuff is covered in our AJAC 305. What are the services we have been given for the governance to control the access? What are the services we have been given for monitoring? AJAC 305 talks about that under the objective domain named as desired identity governance. In an exam, there can be up to 30% questions related with that topic. Actual deployment of storage services and all that will be covered in a DP series of the program, but here we will be talking about how we'll design that, when we should go with the Databricks, when we should go with the Azure Synapse, when we should use Data Lake or Blob. That stuff will be covered in here, and up to 25% question can be there. For BCDR, backup and replication related services and the concept we have been given, there can be up to 20% question in your exam if you're planning to write down that. And then related with the compute, app service, your networks. So related with that, like how you're gonna design the infra, there can be again up to 35% question. Okay, in our exam, you're gonna get the two type of the questions, actually two section of the question. You will be getting two section in the exam. One will be scenario based section, and another one will be case study. When I talk about scenario base, here you'll get the question where you need to select the multiple options as an answer, and means the multi choice question you will be getting, and single choice questions also will be there. Along with the single choice questions, you're gonna get the hot area question, drag and drop questions, where you need to arrange the answers in the right order. Okay, that stuff will be covered, but along with that, there is a one more type of the question we have been given in here. That is called yes no type of the question. In a yes no type of the question, what happened? They talk about the problem, which an administrator is facing right now or organization is facing. And along with that problem, they actually propose the solution as well. We need to just choose the option, yes, this solution solves the problem, or no, this solution does not solve the problem. I mentioned most important, why did I say that? Because this is the only type of the question we have been given in a scenario base where we do not have the review. We cannot review the questions. Sorry, we cannot review the answers. Review means if you have already moved to the next question, you cannot come back and change the answer. That's a challenge on it. Because for the same problem, they actually propose multiple solutions in a different questions. You can get the 3, 4, or sometimes 5 questions as well for the same problem. Out of 3 or 4 or 5, whatsoever the number of the questions you got in there, you get in there, only one question has answer yes, because only one solution is correct. Rest of the other solutions are not correct, right? So sometimes it happens with us, like when we read the question number one, we realize this is the solution gonna solve the problem. But when we move on next question, we realize no, previous one was not correct, but this one is correct. So we will not be able to go back and change the answer. Rest of the other questions can be reviewed. And along with that, we have been given the case study. When we talk about case study, they gives us the yellow field of one fictionary organization. In there, they're gonna let us know what they already have. Along with that, they'll talk about what is the requirement of that organization. And further, based on these two factors, there will be questions. Okay. Here you may get the plus 5+ questions, can be like 10 questions also. Here you'll get the 40+ questions. Most of the time, minus 60 questions you get in there in total. Combined time given to you, there is no separate time for these different sections, so you need to manage the time. You have the choice to write down the exam at testing center, or you can go with the OnVUE software. Using it, you can write down the exam from your home or from your office, at your home or from your office, whichever the most comfortable place for you, you can just go with that and write down the exam. Fair enough. That's all about the exam. If you guys are planning to write down that solution architect exam of Microsoft Azure, so let's talk about the things we are here for. So any organization which is planning to adapt the cloud services means planning to move the infra or the services on the cloud. Microsoft has given us certain guideline or the path or plan path, like this is how you can move to cloud infra. So when we talk about this adoption path, there is no fixed path for the same, which actually works for all organization. But Microsoft has guide us about the different stages which we can follow in order to move the services or the infra on Microsoft Cloud. We can start our journey towards the cloud with the defining the strategies. We can make the plan, can keep the environment or organization ready, and then further we start migrating the things. So different phases are there when we talk about strategies. That's a phase where we justified, okay, this particular service we're going to use on a cloud, and this kind of the problem we're going to solve using it. Okay, so we define the business justification and what outcome we are expecting if we move to the cloud. Okay, under the planning, okay, how we're going to move it, what are the actionable adoption plan we will be talking about to achieve that business outcome, that something discussed, covered under the plan stage. And then we prepare the environment or the infra. For an example, we are migrating a virtual machine which is hosted on premises on Hyper-V or maybe ESXi, or it might be a physical machine as well, which has the specific hardware configuration that may be sufficient, or that may be like a over-provision machine as well for that application. When we'll move the machine or the application hosted on that machine on a cloud, what will be the resource requirement? What will be the size which will be sufficient for? So that we need to get the idea about whether that machine is a good candidate to migrate or not. So that all stuff we'll actually do under the planning phase, means ready phase. We'll prepare the cloud environment, means we'll have a proper subscriptions, we'll plan the we'll apply the governance requirement, and then further using the appropriate tool we're gonna migrate. And to manage that migration part, we have been given a one centralized hub service available on Azure platform only, that is called Azure Migrate. That's a centralized or hub service where we can integrate all migration tools. All migration tool for the database, for the VDI, for web app, for the machines. Can be from Microsoft or can be from different ISVs. Independent software vendors we have been given, like Zerto is there, CloudMize is there. So those all tools you can integrate, and at one centralized point or one place, you can look at all type of the migrations going on. Once the service is migrated, we're going to apply the governance restrictions of the policies which need to be followed. For that one, we have been given the services, and then further plan and backup and BCDR strategies will be applied. That's the high level idea about the different stages which need to be followed by the organization which is moving the services or the infra or the applications on the cloud. So when we move the services on the cloud, as I said, we may have a questions about the cost. We may have a questions about the redundancy. We might have a concerns of the security. So Microsoft has given us the framework, which is actually a set of the best practices which are designed to help us to build a secure, high-performing, resilient, and one more keyword over there, efficient cloud solutions on Azure. So this framework focus on few foundation pillars, like it focus on cost optimization, where we actually think about managing the cost. I will be covering that part in upcoming upcoming slides. Like how we gonna, that means we need to analyze the resource utilization. As I said before, migrating the machine to cloud, we have been given a number of the analysis tool. We're gonna use them. We will be getting the idea about whether this machine is a good candidate to migrate or not. What are the application dependencies it has? Is there any compliance restrictions in order to move it? What will be the optimum size if we'll move it from here to there? So we analyze the resource uses and what are the cost saving opportunities we do have under the cost optimization. We actually look after that. To help us out, we have been given a service on Azure named as Advisor. That advisor help us out about these all things. If there is any scope of the cost optimization, we can do that stuff. Once we analyze, decide, we implement the strategies to optimize the spending. What are the key point or the services we have been given for that? I'll talk about it. Furthermore, operational excellence, this process, if I talk about it, it actually ensure system or the services we are using on a cloud runs smoothly. It define or implement the procedure for the deployment, how we're going to deploy the things, how we're going to monitor the things. If any kind of the issue is there, how we're going to troubleshoot? How we'll react to any kind of the incident triggered in that? Performance pillar actually focus on the ability of our computer system or sorry, application or the services to adapt the changes in the load. Because sometimes we may have a higher load when we have a peak hours. When we have off peak hours, we may have a low demand of the resources. So how our environment or the infra or a cloud gonna handle that kind of the situation? So that involve optimizing the application and infra to deliver the best possible performance. And guys, performance is not only the concern. If it is only the concern, then simply we know that stuff like, okay, my application in a peak hours need 10 instances. Fine, in place of 10, deploy 15 or 20, we'll get the performance. But performance actually comes along with the cost as well. So when we think about performance and cost both, there is a term comes in the picture that is called scalability. So how we'll ensure the scalability here, that stuff is actually covered under the performance efficiencies. There is no magic is being done on the cloud. Whatever the services we are using or we were using on premises, same type of the services, same services have been deployed by cloud vendors in their infra or in their data centers. Maybe 1,000 or 10,000 times more than whatever we had in on-premises environment. So we are, let's say for an example, if I'm deploying the virtual machine, there is no magic is going on. It's kind of the universal fact when we deploy the machine, it will be hosted on a hypervisor. When we deploy the machine on-premises, we may have a Hyper-V from Microsoft. We may have a ESXi from VMware. We may have a Citrix Gen server from Citrix, obvious. And then we deploy the virtual machine. If we do the same thing, means we create the virtual machine on a cloud, regardless of which cloud you're talking about, machines are hosted on a hypervisor. That's a different thing. Those are abstracted, not visible to us. We do not have a control on it, but machines are hosted on a hypervisor. If machines are hosted on a hypervisor, what if that hypervisor goes down? What if that rack goes down? So how we ensure the reliability of the service, or let's say that entire data center is down, do we have anything which we can use to avoid the outage or we can reduce the impact of? So reliability is another pillar which we consider, which we think before moving the services on a cloud. And then furthermore, security. Most confusing part of the cloud. As I said, you might have met with so many people who simply say cloud is not secure. Guys, when we talk about cloud services or moving a cloud, security is not a concern. We have options and services available on a cloud, which we can use to make the resources secure more than it was in on-premises environment. So security is not a concern, but the control is the concern. I do have one simple example. Let's say I do have a 10,000 INRs, or like, let's say $1,000, but there is no proper place to keep it. I don't have a secure vault or locker kind of this stuff. I'm carrying it in my pocket. While as my friend or my colleague has the proper locker for the same, and he or she is offering to keep my money in there. I choose to keep it in my pocket, even though I know it is not secure there. It is more secure in the locker. And security is not a concern in this example as well, because I know it will be secure in a locker. But the moment I put my money in someone else's locker, I'm going to lose the control on. So control is actually the concern, not the security. So we have to decide like which service we need to use in there in order considering the control we want to have on that service. And the another thing is, that's the beauty of the cloud overhead. When we move on the cloud, we actually lose some degree of control, but we get rid of the overhead as well. What degree of the overhead will be reduced, that is depend on again type of the service, because services offered on a cloud are categorized under IaaS, PaaS, SaaS. So let's talk about what are the things we have been given for the security, reliabilities, and all that. Okay, so when we talk about security, any of the workload we are running or we have hosted on Azure platform, how we'll consider any of the workload secure? If it is resilient to attacks, if it incorporates the interrelated security principles. When we talk about the principle, that principle can be of the like a confidentiality, integrity, availability. These are the three things we actually try to achieve. Does it incorporate the principle of the confidentialities, integrities, availabilities, and meeting the business requirement or business goals? So any security incident has the potential to become a major breach and damage that can damage the brand and reputation of the workload of the organization. So to avoid that situation or scenarios, we have been guided to follow the principle of ZTM, which stands for Zero Trust Model. When we talk about this Zero Trust Model, it follows three principles. The principle which actually guide about how the security should be implemented. And these principles are verify explicitly, least privilege, and assume breach. Verify explicitly means it says always authenticate. Always authorized based on the different data points available, like user identities, based on the location, based on the device, based on the services, workload, based on data classification, because sometimes we may have a data which is there for public consumption, like marketing posters, campaigns related information. We want more and more people to use that, to see that. At the same time, we may have some data which is confidential for the organization. Based on anomalies as well, we can authenticate on authorize. Like we know there is a user named as X. That user always log in from India. But all of a sudden, there is a sign-in request for that user account somewhere from Europe, Africa, USA. So that is kind of the anomalies can be detected here and how we can react it. We have been given a different services for the same. You'll get the idea about that in a different program like SC300 or AZ305. But yes, verify, always verify right person, right application is trying to connect and right to right person, right application is trying to use the services. Another principle followed under the JET3M that is called least privilege access. We have a team of the employees who are responsible for certain tasks or jobs, grant them access as per their jobs. So least privilege access, like you must be using RBAC, I'm pretty sure, role-based access control, because that's not something which is available in Azure. It is more of the approach used in almost all the applications. So we grant the access so that user can accomplish the task, that identity can accomplish the task, but more, no more access is given to him or her or to it. Okay. Along with RBAC, we have been given a power of just-in-time access. We have been given a power of just enough access. Along with that, some services available or feature available in an intra-ID that gives us the risk-based adaptive policies. Data protection we have been given to protect the data and the productivity of the employees or the users. There are a number of the Defender solutions we have been given. If you interact with any SOC analyst and get the idea about Defender solutions like Defender for Identity, Defender for Endpoint, Defender for O365, or Defender for Cloud. Like if I talk about Defender for Cloud, there is one component given in there that is called Secure Score, which give you some percentage here and will let you know how much secure you are. Higher Secure Score means lower the identified risk. By any chance, if you see 100% secure score there, Microsoft says, do not assume you are 100% secure. 100% secure score means there is no identified risk. But there is always a scope of some unidentified risk. And this is why SOC analyst has been given a power, of hunting and then TI and so many other things over there. So assume breach, segment your network, segment the access by the network, by the users, the devices, applications, encrypt the data. Along with that, always keep eyes on what's going on, use the analytics to get the visibility, to detect the threats. And these all principles are actually used for these total foundation pillars. And guys, JET3M, Zero Trust model is not something which is for the cloud only. It is recommended in our on-premises day-to-day operations as well. So all the elements work together and provide end-to-end securities. And when I talk about these elements, these elements have total 6 foundation pillars. Like identity is one of them. Identity is an object which is created in an intra-ID or ADDS. That may be a user, that may be a service, that may be a device. When I talk about user, can be a guest user, can be a member user. Member user also can be further two type. Like it can be a cloud user or it can be a hybrid user. Hybrid user is the one which is synchronized from ADDS to intra-ID, formerly known as Azure Active Directory. The detail for the same you'll get in a SC series of the course that is called SC300. You can read about that all stuff on MS Learn also. So when any of the identity try to access the resource, it must be verified with a strong authentication. I'm pretty sure you know what authentication is, a process to verify right person, right identity is trying to connect, which is generally performed based on a user account and the password. But we have been given a modern authentication method. Along with that username and password, some additional detail can be verified under MFA, which works on the basis of something you are, something you have, something you know. And for the identities, it refer, we follow least access privileges given. Devices is the landing point. It actually creates the attack surface as the data flows from the devices to on-premises workload and cloud as well. So keep eyes on the devices. Same goes for the applications as well. Applications are the way that define like how the data is consumed. So we must get to know what are the applications being used in our organization. Because even we have trained our staff, our users, but still any user may install something which is not compliant. So we may have a shadow IT in our organization in parallel. So we must know what are the applications being used. Because not all applications are managed centrally. So sometimes some unknown or some applications can be there which are not compliant as per the regulation or the standard being followed by the organization. For that one, we have been given a one cloud solution that is known as MDCA, Microsoft Defender for Cloud App, formerly known as MCAS, Microsoft Cloud App Security, which is a CASB solution of Microsoft, which we manage from security.microsoft.com. Earlier, it used to have its own portal. Furthermore, data. We must classify the data, as I said previously. We may have some type of the data which we actually invest the money, or we spend the money, or like a lot of money we spend, or we advertise so that more and more people will see it. The marketing campaign, posters, and all that. At the same time, we may have something which is not really, supposed to be shared within the organization also. So we must classify the data, we must label it, encrypt it based on different attributes. We may have an infra on-premises, we may have a cloud-based infra as well that represents a threat vector. So to improve the security, it is recommended to assess the version, the configuration, the access, EITs, use the different telemetries to detect the attack. Network must be segmented. Like here, if I talk about Azure, we have been given a VNet, and within the VNet, we created a subnet. Same as we have a physical network, and that physical network may have a multiple subnets. Based on TCP/IP configuration, we can have a multiple subnet. Possibility is there. Machine 1 and 2 are in one network, machine 4 and 5. Sorry, 3 and 4 are in a different network. Same approach can be used here as well if we need it. If you have a question, how many subnets should be created in a VNet? That's cross. We have a cross question for the same. How many subnets we created on-premises? That's totally depend on your business requirement. Okay, so these are the different principles followed over there under the for the different foundation pillars. Now, if we talk about security, guys, what are the things we can implement in the name of the security? Okay, so we have been given a in the name of the security, it is said use the identities from intra ID, which is a cloud service. Gives us the identity access management. Using that, we can implement the strong access control, which grant the access to only the user whatsoever the access need to be given. For that one, we have been given a role-based access control. We have been given a conditional access policies, which is nothing but the if and then policy that we can use to define if like user A accessing application B, allow that user access. But if the same user accessing application C, no, block it. If user A accessing application D from location E, allow that access, but only if MFA is performed. So we can define if and then statement using conditional access. Plus, we have been given a feature in under premium P2 license of intra ID that is called intra identity protection, where we leverage the power of Microsoft TI, where Microsoft claimed to analyze 6.5 trillion signal daily. And whatever the knowledge they acquire by analyzing these many signals are used under the concept of Microsoft threat intelligence. Because there is one thing I say, regardless of how smart we are, our scope is just one organization only. If we have a full access in that organization, we can look at the data, logs, and events of that organization only. What's going on in a other organization, in the same city, in the same country, we have no idea about that. But that's not the case with the Microsoft. Microsoft has an ecosystem across the globe. So 6.5 trillion signal they analyze alone from the identities only. So use that power. For protecting the network, we have been given the the concept of, segmentations, means we have a VNet, we can create a different subnet in there. On those subnet, we can apply the NSG. NSG is a stateful firewall which allows us to limit the traffic coming in, going out. What should be allowed, what should not be allowed. Simple protection we have been given, which is recommended to implement protection or filter your east-west traffic. Along with that, at the same time, we have been given one robust solution named as Azure Firewall, which has a built-in high availability, scalability in itself. Along with that, it actually helps us to define the network rule. We can implement the application rule. We can create or define the netting rule as well. Along with that, it gives us the DNS proxy. Can work like the layer 3 device also. And when we talk about governance part, we have been given a service there that is called Azure Policy. Azure Policy actually helps us to define attributes of the service instances we are deploying. For an example, Bhaskar is an employee or an administrator of the organization. And he has a power, or he has the rights, not the power, sorry. He has the rights to create or configure the storage account. We can define that stuff using RBAC. Bhaskar should be able to create the storage account. But my compliance requirements are, or my requirement is, anyone creating the storage account in a subscription one should create the storage account using standard LRS SKU. Maybe my organization want to implement it in order to control the cost. This is only the attribute of the storage account is allowed. We can define it using Azure Policy. And guys, I'll recommend you to have a look on RBAC and Azure Policy, because at the first glance, RBAC and Azure Policy look similar. These are not. RBAC focus on user action, what user can do. And we have been given a deny assignment as well, so it can define what user cannot do. While as if we talk about Azure Policy, policy focus on attributes of the service instances we are deploying. We can define RBAC on a management group, on subscription, on resource group, or individual resources. While as Azure Policy can be defined on a management group level, on a subscription level, or the resource group level. We cannot define it on individual resource itself, like a VM1. Whatever the data we do have, we need to safeguard about the data. That data may be at rest, that may be in a transit. Maybe it is being processed. So we need to safeguard it when it is at rest, it is in transit, or it is being processed. We have been given encryption services for the same. One example is there, like SSE, TDE, ADE. Use the one. What about the high availability, guys? A high availability sometimes misunderstood with the concept of fault tolerance. When I ask people what is a high availability, sometimes I get the response or the answer, zero downtime. If we implement or if our application is highly available, means zero downtime, which is not true. When we say zero downtime, it's fault tolerance. The intention or the objective, not intention, but objective of high availability is to reduce the outage as much as possible. Reduce the outage up to its minimal level, basically. So when we have the things on premises, we have the control on each and everything. But what if we are using the cloud services? Let's say I'm a user who I'm an application administrator, and I want to host my application on a virtual machine. Then further, I think about this, the high availability. What will be the high availability of the application hosted on a virtual machine? So we know that we have been given a portal, we have been given a PowerShell, we have been given a Bash shell or REST API as well. Different interface tool we have been given. Whichever the interface tool I'm comfortable, I'll use that. And the fact is, regardless of what interface tool we are using, we will be connecting or landing on the same layer, which is a cloud management layer. The one which we call as ARM, Azure Resource Manager. So this is the guy who received the request. Let's say I'm creating a virtual machine using a portal or PowerShell, ARM gonna receive it. It is the one which defines the RBAC. It is the one which defines the policies. It is the one which defines the tagging. So it's gonna receive the request. If I'm eligible, I will be able to initiate that request, and then it's gonna check it out. Whatever Bhaskar is trying to do, is it compliant as per the policies? Regulatory standards, answer is yes. Then ARM gonna hand over it to another guy, which is known as resource provider. Because we do not see any of the hypervisor, no visibility on it. So as an administrator of that machine or the application, I do not even have the clue which of the hypervisor it is hosted on. What if that hypervisor is down? Microsoft says, okay, we'll restart your machine on a healthy hypervisor. What if that level of availability is not okay for my application? Then in that case, we can leverage something which is called availability set. Microsoft asks us to deploy the multiple instances, but the problem is this resource provider named as Microsoft.compute is quite innocent. It does not have the idea Bhaskar is creating these two virtual machines for the same application, so I should place these VMs on different hypervisor or different rack. What if both machines hosted on same hypervisor or maybe in the same rack? So to educate Microsoft.compute resource provider, we configure availability set, where we define you need to keep these virtual machines in these three racks or these two racks. Not these two racks, means in two racks or three racks. We define in these many update domains you need to keep your machine so that we can avoid the outage. But if we use the availability set, in that case, what happened, guys? Our virtual machines are hosted in the same data center. Yes, it is true on different rack. So if any hypervisor failed, any rack failure is there, my application will not be fully down because other two racks are working fine. I do have some instances hosted on other rack, which I do not see. But my application can be down if the entire data center failure is there. What if I am looking the protection for my application, or I want to reduce the outage in case of that entire data center of Microsoft is down? Then in that case, Microsoft has given us something which is known as availability zone. which is a Microsoft investment. Basically, it is a physical location in a region. There are some region where we have a multiple physical location. That physical location further can be a group of the data center. But consider one data center is there right now. So leveraging availability zone, we ensure these VMs we are deploying in a three different zone or three different data centers. So if machines have been deployed in three different data center, if one data center is down, no problem, other two are working. So this is how we can ensure the high availability of the compute. But in that case as well, what if that entire region failure is there? Like back in 2015, if you guys have the idea about that, in 2015, entire Chennai region was down. Entire city was down around for like 48 hours. So such kind of a situation can be there. Regional disasters are not really uncommon. Can be there. So if we are looking the protection, that in that case, that comes under the BCDR, Business Continuity Disaster Recovery. For that one, we can leverage the another service available on Azure Cloud named as ASR. Using that, we can replicate the service. We can leverage the Traffic Manager, which is a traffic distributor. We can deploy the service instances of application in three different zones three or four different regions. And those all application instances can be placed behind the Traffic Manager. This guy works on the basis of DNS query and uses a multiple routing method like performance routing method, geographic routing method, weighted routing method, priority routing method. So let's say if we are using the priority routing method, it's going to prioritize one of the endpoint deployed in East US. If it goes down because of any problem, it will start redirecting the user request to another endpoint which has the higher priority in absence of the first one. So this is how we can ensure the redundancy of the application or the service. Plus, we are recommended to proactively keep eyes on using the Azure Monitor Unified Service, where we have been given a number of the tools. Set up the cross-region replication for the virtual machines if you want to ensure the resiliency in case of regional failure. And keep eyes on, again, Azure Monitor. Okay. One more point. How we'll ensure or how we can reduce the cost? What are the different factors we have been given? So when we talk about the cost of the service instances on Azure or any cloud, depend on what service we are using. There will be a X amount of the cost for the firewall, and there will be a different cost for the virtual machine, different cost for the VNG. If I talk about the VM or the compute resources only, how many compute instances we are using? How much RAM we are using? How many CPU cycles we are using? Along with that, the bandwidth we are consuming. How much space we are consuming? That space is coming from SSDs or coming from HDDs. That is something we can specify by going with a premium or standard SKUs. Data transfer is also one factor. Network uses, virtual network uses, load balancers, which include the inbound and outbound data transfer cost, VPN gateway, express route, that all comes under the networking cost. There will be a cost of the database, like SQL database we are using, Cosmos DB, different cost will be there. Depend on the size of the data, which region you are deploying, what are the transactions on that database we do have, what is the performance tier we are going with. I deploy the virtual machine and I migrated that machine from on-premises environment which has the license with the software assurance. So rather than purchasing a license of the operating system from Azure Marketplace, I decided to use that hybrid license. So license is also something which actually important factor. Along with that, what pricing model we are using? We might be going with the pay-as-you-go pricing model. Or in place of that, we can make the commitment, which is called reservation. Where we gonna make the commitment with the Microsoft to use the service for certain time or certain level. It is not always a commitment for the time. Sometimes we can make the commitment to use it for certain level. And when we make the commitment, Microsoft offer the discount in response of that commitment. Like I'm using log analytic workspace, where I make the commitment to ingest 100 GB logs and event daily basis. They can give us the discount of 15% or 20%. So in place of the paying the cost of 100 GB, I will be paying the cost of 80 GB. And guys, whenever we talk about reservation, the point comes in our mind is it's something which is a cheaper solution. But in order to use it, we have to consider the uses. Do we have really that much uses? Yes, they are offering the 20% discount if we are making the commitment to ingest the 100 GB data in the log analytic workspace. But my actual use is maybe around 10 GB or lesser than that. Okay? So you may choose to go with the pay as you go, or sometime when you have a high uses or you plan to use it for certain time period, you can leverage the reservation and can reduce the cost. Same size of the VM might be available at different price. So select the geographic location as well. When we talk about geographic location, there is a simple straightforward statement from Microsoft regarding that. Deploy your resources close to your consumers, so that we can ensure the least latency, lower latency for that service instance. But that's just the recommendation only. Maybe the size of the VM or the SKU of the instance we are looking for is not available in nearby region. Maybe that specific feature is not in there. Maybe the cost of the nearby region is higher. One simple example, if you purchase iPhone in India, you're gonna pay X amount. Same model in Dubai, maybe X minus one. If you purchase the same model in USA, X minus two. And every time you are purchasing the same model, local factors come in a picture and impact the cost. Let me give you the example for the same. Here, if I go with Azure price calculator. Just quick example, please. Though time and we are running out of the time. Just a quick example. See that? Oh. See that? I am planning to deploy it in West US. That's the hours, instance, license, pricing model, and see the cost, $157. And if I change it to East US, I say, no, I'm not deploying it in West US, but deploying in East US, see the price. $137. If I say no, I will be going with the reservation instance where I make the commitment to use it for 3 years. See that price is synced to $94 now. And along with that, if I say no, I will be using my own license. I don't need to purchase a license from Microsoft. So around $27 I'm paying for the same VM, for which earlier I was paying $152 or $53. right? So different factors are there which help us to control the cost of the resources. Pricing model, location, type of the resource, what is the actual consumption of it? It is recommended to go with the right size of the resources, because deploying the resources in a cloud is just a matter of clicks only, guys. In place of going with the size X, if I go with the size Y of the VM, just one click. But every click gonna cost us here. So choose the right size of the resources. If it is feasible, go with the reservation instances in place of pay as you go. But that is something I have already clarified, not true all the time. That's totally depend on their use cases. Use the cost management solution we have been given in there, which is categorized under SaaS. Using that cost management solution, you can define the budget and you can set the alert. If I consume a certain amount of the budget, it should generate the alert for me. And then further, we have been given our operational excellence. To achieve that operational excellence, monitoring is something which is recommended. We have been given Azure Monitor, which is a comprehensive monitoring solution which collect, analyze, and act on the telemetries. The telemetries from your cloud resources, and not limited to cloud resources only, guys. We can collect the telemetries or logs and event data from on-premises resources as well. We have been given a metric which collect and analyze the numeric data on the performance of your resources. Logs is something which can be used for, like I would say, RCA purpose. Metrics are generally used for troubleshooting, gives us the real-time, gives us the idea about the real-time scenarios, what's going on now. And when we need to analyze something, maybe analyzing a trend, maybe we need to get the idea about root cause, then logs or something can be used in there. Smart Alert is a wonderful tool which you can configure to be triggered in response of particular condition or in response of particular metric. When particular conditions met, it should trigger. And it should take the simple actions like send the email or SMS, or you can execute the runbook, logic app, function, which is not written there, which is a serverless computing service available on Azure. We have been given an insight, application insights, that also you can use to get the idea about, monitor your network, monitor your application. We have been given a service in a Azure Monitor named as Workbook. Using that, you can create a dashboard. You can configure your portal. When you log in, you should land on the home screen, or you should land on the dashboard so that you can get the quick glance what's going on about the particular service. So alert is something which actually helps us to detect and address the certain issues which may impact our organization. So building a resilient and cost-effective solutions in Azure asks us to leverage the combination of the best practices, the number of the tools we have been given, the services we have been given. Using them, we can ensure applications are reliable. Along with the reliability, we get it at the economical rate. So there are different concepts we discuss here. Reliability ensure our application can be recovered from failure. It is able to maintain the high availability. For that one, I said use the high availability zone. Use the availability zone. Use the availability set. Use the ASR to protect the data center failure. That can help us to ensure the continuous operations. For cost optimization, we have been given the cost management solutions, reservation instance we discuss. Go with the right size of the resources. Right size of the VM gonna give you the performance efficiencies. Security, you have been given an Azure Security Center, which is known as Microsoft Defender for Cloud now. Need to get the more detail about it. SC200 course is there for the guys. Book is available online. You can just read about that one, or you can go for the instructor-led program. Best practices, right size of the resources, I already mentioned. Select the correct geographic location, because Microsoft recommend to go with a nearby region. We have been given a 70 plus operation region, guys. And security or cost or resiliency, availability is not something one-time configuration or one-time task. Keep eyes on. Regular testing is something which is recommended. Always conduct the regular mock drills, disaster recovery testings, performance testing that gonna ensure your solution works as you expect. Monitoring alert, we have discussed about, we have been given a cost management solution that gonna help us out to be in a certain budget. Okay. AZ305 is the course of 32 hours, which covers in 4 days. I tried to cover the summary of that in just 1 hour. Thank you for joining in, guys. Let me know if there is any questions regarding anything we covered here, we discuss here. Please do not forget to fill up your valuable feedback. That's important for us. Oh, previous slide. Hold on. Is it the one you're talking about? Nanda? Or this one? Okay, what's the question? Is there any question? Azure Monitor is the tool, not the tool, but the collection of the tool, Nanda. When you'll go in Azure Monitor Blade, you'll see the number of the tools over there. Like you can see the Metric Explorer, you have been given a log analytic workspace, you have been given the alert, which you can configure, okay, when that particular condition triggered, it should give me a notification. And in response of notification, you can define the action group as well. Okay, when there is a notification, send the email on my group email ID or send the SMS on my team on call number. Or in place of simple action, you can take some sophisticated actions like execute function, which has a certain code. Application Insight is the another tool. So this is the that everything is a part of Azure Monitor, which is a service. Okay, you need to keep eyes on a network. We have been given a free tool over there that is called Network Watcher. Along with that, we have been given a free the advisor. You just go on that. Here, if it is visible, portal.azure.com. I don't have any resource deployed in my subscription, but if you'll go there and based on your resources deployed, it will give you the idea about that all foundation pillar we discuss here. See that? We have been given an advisor. That's a free tool, which is totally based on your well-architect framework. It'll give you the idea about the cost, security, reliability, operational excellence. Like say this one, there are two recommendations for the reliability. Two recommendations for the security. You click on it, it gives you idea about. It says management port of the virtual machine should be protected using just-in-time network access. Because I have kept the port number 3389 open on this on the machine deployed in there. And it says maximum three owners should be there on Azure subscription. So some recommendations we get in there regarding the reliabilities, cost, so whatever the factors we discuss, advisor is the one which gonna focus on. Any other question? Shoot it, please. We are done for the day. Thanks for joining in. Please do not forget to fill up the feedback. That's important for us. Okay, I tried to give you the summary of that AZ305, the services can be used to optimize the instances or the cloud services. Thank you for joining in.